This was quite a difference when we only built half a Kenner chassis, wasn't it?
It's Bruce's idea, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah, much more confidence about all this metal work here.
Whatever he suggested, you just kind of went ahead and did it, and it usually worked out all right.
It was helped enormously by Bruce's charisma.
He was quite a good race driver. He was a very good test driver. I don't know, he just had all those attributes of a guy that you followed and was interested in, and so I thought it'd be a good idea if I hung around and saw what happened, and so that's kind of what I did. In that time period, the safety of motor racing itself, Can-Am Formula One racing and stuff, was really atrocious.
Yeah.
I was at Indianapolis, and I was sitting having breakfast with Dan Gurney when there was a phone call, and it was Teddy calling from London. Bruce had been killed in the Can-Am testing down at Goodwood that morning, when Bruce was dead. And that's when Teddy said, well, best you get back here and help us sort things out.
I got everybody together in the workshop and told them what had happened, asked them if they would just tidy up and go home.
They did go home, but they came back in the next day, even though they were told they didn't need to. Teddy Mayer gave his sort of very short, crisp speech saying, well, you know, this is a terrible thing, but we have a Can-Am race in 2 weeks, and best we get on with it. We did show up with the two cars and the two drivers at Mosport. Dan agreed to drive the second car for us. He played around with the car because he didn't really have any practice time in it or testing in it or anything. And it was about 10 minutes left in qualifying when I remember saying to Dan, by the way, we need to qualify. Well, he said, okay, hopped in the car and put it on pole position and won the race.
Yeah, that's right. They still sound fantastic.